Hi guys, Omores here. So I just spent $49 on this box, and honestly I think I got a great deal. Why? Because with what's inside, and as long as we have enough free PCIe slots, we can turn a modern PC into the ultimate Windows 9X retro machine. So let's check what's in the box and if it works. First, we have a PCIe to USB 2 card from Delock. This one is supposed to be used, but honestly, it looks brand new, probably just old stock. It uses a NEC PCIe to USB 2 chip paired with a PLX bridge to function in a PCIe slot. It comes with USB 2 drivers for Windows 98, 2000, and XP, and it will be automatically recognized in every other version of Windows. Next, we have a PCIe Gigabit Network Card with a Broadcom 57XX family chip. Now, these chips have been around since PCIe Express first hit the market. Some of them work with Windows 98, but newer ones, well, not always. We have to do some testing later. And finally, the star of the show, an NVIDIA Quadro FX 4500. This beast runs on the G70 chip from 2005. Basically, it's a professional version of the 7800 GTX. Later models used the G71 chip, built on a 90 nanometer process, same as the 7900 series. Now let's see if this card actually starts on this H610 motherboard with a PCI Express 4 slot. While PCIe slots are backward compatible, some VGA BIOSes don't always play nice with newer motherboards. Anyway, on this configuration, when a new video card is detected, the BIOS will check the compatibility with UEFI mode first. If it doesn't work, it will show a warning message, and once that's out of the way, we can finally move on. So far, so good. Our Quadro GPU posted without any issues. Now comes the easy part. This Windows 98 setup already has the necessary NVIDIA drivers installed and optimized. And by optimized, I mean it's running a bunch of patches by Rudolf Loew specifically designed for the 6000 and 7000 series NVIDIA cards. I have covered this process in detail before. Check the link above for more details. Now comes just a quick refresher. First, we have a modified MVCore VXD file. This limits available RAM to 256 megabytes, which is crucial because Windows 98 and NVIDIA cards with 512 megabytes of VRAM don't play well together. Next, there is a patched PCI VXD file, though in some cases this step isn't strictly necessary. And finally, most importantly, we need to run an interrupt fix VXD driver, which has to be loaded through the system .ini file. Now back to our installation. All of this is already done, so this Quadro card should work right from the first try, or at least after the first reboot. And if you recognize the wallpaper, yes, it's the same Windows 98 installation from the Half-Life 2 video. So far, everything looks good. Our 512 megabyte card is being reported as 256, and I'm fine with that. We could get all 512 megabytes back by flashing the card, but that's not happening today. Instead, let's try some overclocking. Quadro cards were priced much higher, way higher, and clocked slower than their GeForce counterparts, so there should be plenty of room for overclocking. Well, when picking a detect optimal frequencies option, the results are pretty good, but not exactly outstanding, considering that a GeForce 7900 GTX can run at 650 MHz. However, we don't know yet if this card has a G70 or G71 chip, since the hardware info programs will match the BIOS description with its own database, and that's it. This is how some fake cards initially could pass a GPU-Z test. The only way to know it is by disassembling the card and checking the markings on the actual chip. Anyway, so far we know it runs stable with a pretty good 3DMark score, considering it's a Quadro. At this point, as I was setting up stuff on the screen for a screenshot, I realized I could improve how the system reports the CPU. So, by using an updated SYSDM.CPL file created in 2015 by none other than Rudolf Loew, I could make it display the exact CPU type by reading the CPU ID. By the way, Windows Millennium already knows how to do that, and now our Windows 98 can do it as well. So with this problem solved, it was time to test some of the newest games that can still run on Windows 98. And one of the best candidates? Well, Half-Life 2 Episode 1. If Half-Life 2, the original release, definitely supported Windows 98, I'm not sure about Episode 1, but one of my subscribers sent me a version that works with Windows 98.
Therefore, I repeat, evacuate City 17 at once, if not sooner. I cannot state this without enough...
With this version, there are some glitches in the menus, but interestingly, the same issues appear in Windows 10, so it's not Windows 98's fault. The sound, however, needed some kernel X magic to get working, but once everything was in place, the game ran at over 100 FPS, so I guess we can't ask for more. Now how about those games? I don't think there will be any issues here. This Quadro card uses the same VGA BIOS that NVIDIA has been putting in so many cards for so many years, and I can tell you it works great with those games. For a quick test, I fired up Rise of the Triad, or ROT if you are into acronyms. The sound, that's handled by the CMI8738 chip, the same one I showed off in my Windows 98 on 14th gen hardware video. And guess what? The game runs perfectly, smooth and fast, plus the image is automatically upscaled to full HD over the DVI output. Now let's take a look at our USB 2.0 PCI Express card. It's the newest card in the pack, based on the manufacturing date, but it uses a 2002 model USB 2 chip from NEC. I have previously used these chips with Windows 98, so compatibility shouldn't be an issue. Initially, Windows 98 will recognize only the USB 1.1 controllers. At this stage, the EACI controllers, which handle USB 2 traffic, will appear as an unknown device until we install the drivers, of course. Once the drivers are loaded, the already installed USB 2 Wi-Fi stick immediately resumes operation, and now we have a functional internet connection. So I think we can definitely call the USB setup using a PCI Express card in Windows 98 a success, especially since no modified drivers or patches were needed. Too bad this specific model is no longer produced. However, we can still get a similar card from StarTech. I actually own one, and so far it has been very useful. While the StarTech option is a bit pricey for a USB 2 card, it has a slight advantage, an included power connector that can provide extra power if needed. And speaking of useful devices, it's time to take a look at the last card from this pack, the PCI Express Gigabit Card from Broadcom. While it isn't as versatile as a USB 2 card, which can accommodate a variety of external devices like optical drives, sound cards, Wi-Fi sticks, and more, I still think it's nice to have. This card features a Broadcom 5761 chip and was manufactured in 2010, while the Windows 98/ME drivers date back to around 2006 and, of course, are not aware of the hardware IDs for this newer chip, which was released around 2009. So my initial approach was to modify the INF file and add the hardware IDs manually. Unfortunately, it didn't work. Then I tried using the generic 57XX entry from the INF file. Since our card theoretically qualifies, it does have a chip that starts with 57, but that didn't work either. Next, I checked my invoice and saw that I had originally ordered a Broadcom 5722 card, so I sent a short email and the store staff were very understanding. They shipped me a 5722 card the same day. Now you might think the 5722 model is much older than a 5761, but that's not the case. This card was manufactured in 2008. Now here's the fun part. This time, after quickly adding the hardware ID into the INF file, the card was initialized by the driver, and as far as I can tell, it's working perfectly. Except I didn't update every single reference in the INF file. As a result, the card appears as a Netlink model in the control panel, but it's actually a Nextstream series card, as confirmed by running the ipconfig command. Now that there is a wire connection, I decided to test out Quake 2 to see if it could still connect to a modern updated server, and sure enough, it works. I didn't have time to play an actual match, but just launching the game with the original Quake 2 files and joining a random server brought back so many memories. Now it's time to wrap things up, and so far with three PCI Express cards we have covered the GPU, networking and even USB 2, which by the way extends compatibility even further. For example, we could use a generic USB audio card, though it wouldn't provide the best experience. So what about a fourth PCI Express card for sound? Well, it's absolutely possible. Let's meet the C-Media 8738 sound card, now on sale in a PCIe 1X format. So why this card? Well, maybe because it works all the way from Windows 95 up to Windows 11 and even has a very good DOS compatibility in Windows 98 and ME when used with VDM drivers. Check out my Windows 98 video for more info. In the end, my ideal setup is a multi-boot system where I can switch almost instantly between Windows 98, 2K, XP, or even Windows NT, because why not? For running Windows 10 or 11, a powerful GPU is usually enough since the motherboard can handle everything else, but for running older operating systems on modern hardware, we need to fill those PCIe slots with compatible cards. So if you are into this kind of stuff, be sure to pick an ATX motherboard with plenty of PCIe slots, and don't forget those PS2 ports. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more.